Welcome back to the program, Jürgen Todenhöfer. One of the things that struck me the most about your video was that you, I think this was in Syria, were with some new recruits, and some of them were already wearing explosive vests. Describe for me what happened there, why that was the case.
A high percentage of the fighters is wearing these belts, these suicide belts, and not to commit suicide, but it's a strategy. If they die in their last moment, they will open this belt and they will kill a dozen of soldiers, of other enemies, of their enemies, and that's what they did also when they conquered Mosul. So, and these belts are very small, very easy to wear. I wore one. It's a horrible feeling.
You wore one? What was it like?
It's horrible. It's you know, the feeling that you kill yourself to kill an enemy is something horrible.
One of the things that you said since you've returned is that the Islamic State is a lot more dangerous than anybody here in the West thinks. Why do you say that?
So I've seen many, many resistant movements, and I met rebels. I met people of Al-Qaeda. I meet also presidents, you know, like Karzai. I don't meet always.
You don't only meet with Al-Qaeda, you meet with...
Yeah, I meet with Karzai and Assad and so on. But Al-Qaeda in comparison, for example, with IS, is an empty shell. It's nothing in comparison with IS.
Now, why do you say that? Is it because they're better organized? Is it because they're more brutal? Is it because of their ideology? Where does this come from all of a sudden?
It comes from their success. It comes from their simple ideology. It comes from this enthusiasm that nobody can explain. I told you I spent 2 days in a registration house where 50 people arrived every day. And when I saw these brilliant eyes, these happy guys, and not losers who may have lost their lives or missed their lives in their home countries, winners, people who you cannot imagine, or in the city of Mosul, I met people from Belgium, I met people from France, Britain, and Sweden. A wonderful Swedish guy, blonde Swedish guy, and I said, what are you doing here? And he said, it's the time of my life. And I said, why? And he saw that I didn't understand him, and I didn't understand him. I cannot understand that, and you will not understand it. That is, it's incredible. It's a very, very strong movement. I repeat it like a tsunami, like a nuclear tsunami.
You spoke to a fighter from Europe, from Germany, and he made that point very clear. We're going to have a look at that right now.
We will conquer Europe someday. It is not a question of us wanting. We will. That's certain. What if the 150 million Shiites that there are in the world refuse to convert? Will they get killed? We'll kill 150 million, 200 million, 500 million. We don't care about the number. The Islamic State has made a spectacle of beheading people. You reintroduced slavery. You have enslaved the Yazidi. Do you believe the decapitation and slavery are progress for humanity? Progress or not, I think this will always be a part of human life. And it is part of our religion to instill fear in the disbelievers. And we are going to continue to behead people. It doesn't matter whether they're Shiite, Christians, or Jews. And we're going to continue to practice this. And people should think about James Foley. He and the others didn't die because we started the battle. They died because their ignorant governments didn't help them.
This German guy, what was he like? He seemed pretty eloquent.
He's very eloquent. He knows a lot, and I knew him quite well because I had Skype conversations with him during 7 months. So I spoke with him at least 14, 16 hours about his ideology. And
so he is someone who has credibility within ISIS. He is someone who
says what they want him to say. He is a kind, he's not the official spokesman. but he doesn't say a single word which is not the opinion of the so-called caliph. And he comes from Germany. He left Germany with a group of 10 people from Solingen. Two are already dead. And he is he's very strong in ideology, very strong in history. And he's sure that he is on the right way. Completely sure. I had no chance, never. I tried to persuade him that this way was wrong. I never had a chance.
There's a lot of things that we need to talk about after seeing that interview. One of them is the threat of former ISIS members coming back to America, coming back to Europe, and committing terror attacks there. Because people say that's a big threat. What do you think?
No, that's not the main threat. IS is a huge threat. And even the people who come back may commit a terrorist attack. They did it, I think, in France or in Belgium. But the people who come back have lost. They are not the winners. They had problems with the system. It was too hard for them to fight, or the life was too hard, or their wife wanted them to go back. These are the people who didn't make it. And therefore, they are not the biggest danger. The biggest danger in our countries are people who are now thinking to go to Syria and to Iraq, or as they say, to the Islamic State, and who could commit a suicide attack or something like that before leaving. But I suggest we should never underestimate the terrorist danger of IS in our countries. But their plan is, in the long run, to attack also our countries. So when I spoke, for example, with this German about the terrorist danger in Germany, he said, our main problem will be when we come with our troops.
So they want to attack Europe. They want to attack America.
One day, they will start with Andalusia. And you can say, these are fantasies. This is ridiculous. OK. It sounds ridiculous. It sounds ridiculous also for me. But if somebody had said 6 months ago that at the end of this year, 2014, IS would run a country bigger than UK, bigger than Great Britain, everybody would have said, you're crazy.